All right, so this is Dora Smith from Siemens, and I'm here with Octavio Heredia from Arizona State University, the Ira Fulton School of Engineering. And you just got done presenting. It's quite an interesting presentation, so I know we'll share the slides. But for those that weren't there, how would you explain what the Higher Engineering Education Alliance program is about?
Yeah, so HEEAP's a project that's about, you know, 3 years old now. And really, it is a project that it's working with universities, you know, 8 different educational institutions in Vietnam, a number of industry partners that are members of the alliance, and that it's really the objective. It's to help the Vietnamese people, you know, through the government and through these institutions, to transform their higher engineering educational system, focus around engineering, but now with the goal to be able to be able to provide the tools and the knowledge to, you know, to you know, the universities and their vocational schools to be able to support a new level of economy, a new type of economy that's taking place in Vietnam. And so it's everything from faculty development through leadership training through, you know, English proficiency. You know, it's hard for us to say in a few words this is what it's all about because the project's very ambitious. You know, it's trying to work and change a system, an educational system that has, you know, thousands of years in the making. And so now how do we bring in, you know, change and transformation to create a new type of engineer, a new type of workforce that can support this, you know, high-tech economy that's taking place in Vietnam. So, you know, if there's somebody out there that can come up with it in a few words, I would really appreciate that.
So why Vietnam? Why in particular did you choose that country to focus this efforts on?
So one of the two funding partners that started the project 3 years ago, it's USAID through, you know, through the development efforts that already have some work done in Vietnam. But really the main funding partner was Intel, Intel Corporation, who had basically expressed or already had announced their investment in Vietnam for some of their assembly and test facilities. They actually announced that it was going to be their largest assembly and test facility in the world that was going to take place in Vietnam. And so, as you know, they have a significant facility in Chandler, Arizona as well. So Intel and ASU has a longstanding relationship, you know, everything from research and collaboration to curriculum development that we've forged over the year. And so, you know, once they identified that they were going to have a need to develop a new type of workforce to support their operations in Vietnam, they came to ASU to, you know, see if they were interested in, you know, basically being a partner in this transformation. And so it's not so much that ASU went to Vietnam as much as we were invited to be part of it.
Okay. And so have you seen, it's been 3 years now, so are there graduates, because I think there was both a vocational and a university curriculum, are there graduates already from the program?
No, yet. So we are starting our third year now, and we started with the university tracks. We started with the first, you know, we've probably at that point we had trained 50 faculty, you know, so, you know, and those faculty are teaching at different levels of the university, of their curriculum. So we don't quite have the graduates that have gone through an entire experience with some of the changes that we've recommended, but we're starting to see some student success stories, right? We're starting to get feedback from students. We're starting to get, you know, feedback from, you know, from our industry partners that go on and visit, you know, and see some of the lab results that are taking place. Mm-hmm. So we don't necessarily have that graduate that can go in and be productive on day one at Intel or at, you know, some of the other, you know, high-tech manufacturing places in Vietnam, but we're starting to see some results and some, you know, very good feedback from the students directly. So it's been very motivating in that regard.
Yeah, I think I saw one of your slides, you were speaking about the challenges and then some of the progress. And I thought one of the comments was about how students wanted this sort of same applied concept now in their other classes.
Correct.
So that's a great sign.
Yeah, I mean, and, you know, the what we're working with are the tools that we give to the faculty. It's, you know, how do you bring more group work? How do you bring more, you know, labs and more applied, you know, applied knowledge into the classroom, right? You know, be able to work on some of the communication skills. And so, you know, now students are, you know, delivering presentations, working in groups, you know, things that, you know, that here in the U.S. or, you know, in you know, the Western, you know, engineering educational systems we're very used to, that we can always do better, but we're still, you know, used to that. You know, these are new activities for students. And so, you know, they want to see, you know, they're seeing that or going through that in a few classes, you know, with some of the faculty that we already trained. But they're now excited and they want to do that in other classes. You know, why are some of the other faculty not implementing those same changes? And so, so I think now we're actually able to, you know, get some more advocates in terms of, you know, helping this transformation from the student's voice. And that's, you know, it's great.
Good. So tell me, when you're not out and about speaking at these kind of events, your day job, how did you get to, I guess, ASU and be in this role, and what got you interested in engineering and high tech?
You know, so I think I always had a, you know, from growing up, I think, you know, probably other, you know, engineers will tell you the same story. You know, I was always interested in technology. Computers were, you know, I was growing up, I always wanted to find out how things worked and, you know, why they worked. And
you took them apart so you could put them back together.
Most of the times put them back together. Once in a while, you know, it was just the learning process to take them apart anyways, right? you know, but then, you know, through high school and college, I just, you know, basically loved working with computers and technology and developing software and see, you know, trying to develop problems by using code and writing code. And so I was, you know, I always kind of knew that I was going to be involved in technology. You know, I'm very motivated by learning, and I, you know, I kind of continue to, you know, seek the challenges of learning something new. So I knew technology would give me that environment that it, you know, I would always be able to be challenged if I chose to. So that's kind of how I got into, you know, computer science, you know, undergrad major, and then I pursued a master's in software engineering as well, just trying to, you know, pursue that knowledge. And how I became involved in this, you know, I came to ASU about 10 years ago and started working with engineering and trying to develop our distance learning portfolio. I had experience in that, writing some code, as an undergrad student. You know, and over the years, I've, you know, had the opportunity to develop, you know, into different roles, different capacities within the organization. And, you know, the last 3 years, it's really been working with our faculty, working with our partners on, you know, what we always call taking all of this knowledge that resides within our faculty and within the halls of ASU and be able to deliver that worldwide, right? Whether it be, you know, with other partner universities around the world or delivering training to our corporate partners and their engineers located across the world. And so, you know, it's really, you know, I'm still using, you know, the technology in ways that we can be more efficient in delivering that training and that educational experience. You know, working with our partners to, you know, learn more about their needs and, you know, the pains that they have and ways that we can solve those pains or, you know, train our students the way that they can come in and solve those pains for them. So yeah, it's, you know, it's not necessarily the traditional engineering track. I took a little detour there, but it's been very rewarding in that sense.
I don't know if there is a traditional one these days. What would you say to students that are, you know, maybe in the K through 12 age range and to encourage them to consider computer science, engineering, software engineering as a future career?
You know, I think what would I say? It's, you know, that going in this technology, so engineering or computer science areas, it kind of gives you the knowledge to, you know, to take a look at a problem and gives you the ability to come up with your own solution, right? It might not be the best solution, it might not be the most efficient solution, but it is a solution nonetheless, right? You know, and I think that ability or that power, it can be very rewarding because you can kind of see the results right away, right? You don't necessarily, in some cases, you may not necessarily have to wait very long to see that you're able to turn on a light or that you're able to, you know, control a motor, or you can control, you know, different things. And so you get that feedback right away, and that, you know, that you can see that something that you actually created works and works right away. And, you know, that I think, you know, as a young child, I think I found that fascinating, that, you know, that I could just work on something and see it work right away, or, you know, if not work, then make you wonder why, you know, why it didn't, and then trying to find out ways that could make it work. And so, you know, I think, you know, and it gives you, in computer science, software engineering in particular, it gives you that virtual realm to work with where, you know, you're still not necessarily bound by the laws of physics per se, but you can kind of be a little bit more flexible, a little bit more creative, and then see how far you can push, you know, that environment or those boundaries in a more virtual sort of way. So I think, you know, it allows for a little bit more creativity. You know, I think to me it gives you a little bit more, a wider arena to play with. And so I think that to me it's fascinating, you know. And now, you know, where technology is today, where software and the capabilities, the computing capabilities we have today versus what we had, you know, 10, 12 years ago, mm-hmm. You know, I think it's pretty interesting area to be in.